Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick coming to you from Chicago. We're about to leave Chicago and go to Minneapolis, but the internet here is so slow, so by the time I load this, probably tonight, we'll be in Minneapolis. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to ask you for your prayers, for travels, and for the work that the Lord would have me do in Minneapolis. And we had a lot of spiritual hindrances to get to Chicago, and the things in Chicago, probably the greatest spiritual hindrances I've probably had in the whole time I've been in the ministry, or since I first started when I was new. So I ask for your prayers. Of course, obviously, there's lots of strongholds over a big city, especially like Chicago. You know, we all know that Obama has this principality here. It's based out of Chicago area. So I'm sure that I know that the enemy is not happy, but praise God, you know, God has given us a miracle and the victory over all these things. And I just wanted to give you a little word of wisdom in this video of what the Lord was showing me. And it's basically like this. You know, if you guys know, I mentioned before about one little mentally challenged dwarf Santa Claus on YouTube. And I thought about, you know, the thing about it is a lot of times when people try to do spiritual warfare, they kind of have that Marine mentality, you know, because, I mean, I used to be in the Army, so. But, you know, the Marine mentality, if you will go watch these documentaries from World War II and the battles in the Pacific, you know, like on the History Channel or the Hitler Channel, whatever you want to call it, they always show these battles. And then in some of those islands, I can't remember which one, the Marines was just going on the ground headlong, you know, just head to head against the Japanese on some of these islands, on and on and on for weeks and weeks. And, you know, thousands of Marines were killed. And, you know, the real analysis is that they don't like to say, because it's all about politics, is that a lot of those generals were just doing a ground war. And, well, we're the Marines. We can do it. Instead of being smart and using all the resources available. So in one of these islands in the Pacific in World War II, the Army showed up. And what ended up happening is the Army said, well, you know, let's bring in the gunboats on the ocean from the Navy. Let's bring in artillery. Let's have an air bombardment of these fortifications. Let's don't just do a ground war, you know, direct assault against these strongholds of the enemy. Let's bring in air power. Let's bring in artillery. Let's use something from the air instead of just going head to head at the same level as the enemy strongholds are. And so, brothers and sisters, that's what the Lord was showing me. You know, a lot of times we have that separate fire mentality for fighting head to head and a hard-headed, you know, fighting at that same level that the enemy fights at. But what God wants us to do is go up higher, you know, because even though in the second heaven, the Bible tells us in the second heaven that the enemy has all these powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places, but we have that third heaven, brothers and sisters. The Bible says that we're seated with Christ far above all powers and principalities. So what we have to do in order to win spiritual warfare is stop fighting, you know, eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You know, and I see that with other people on YouTube, and I hope that they see this as really advice for them. Dealing with trolls and all these kind of things on the internet, and the devil's children, witches and wacko people that think they have some wacky doctrine that's not held by anybody but them, and they think that, you know, they don't even know what the doctrines of the denominations are. They go on the internet and start attacking and declaring people, oh, you're a false prophet because you believe in the rapture. You're a false prophet because you teach that, you know, you don't have to speak in tongues to be saved. When in reality, that's what millions and millions of pastors are teaching in these different denominations. They don't even know that. But anyway, they're fighting in the flesh, brothers and sisters. They're fighting at that lowest level on the ground war. But what God has called us to do is come up here and go up higher with Him. See, where we can see, you know, just like if you went to Chicago here and went downtown Chicago. But in this case, I didn't get a chance to because I've been busy for the Lord. And unfortunately, you know, when I go to these places, I don't get to tour and see places, which I would like to sometime. Maybe when I get to heaven, you know, I'm sure it's nicer than Chicago. But anyhow, if you were to go to downtown Chicago, to the Hancock Building and the Sears Tower and all that, and you walk down the street at ground level, those buildings are so tall, brothers and sisters. They're way up there. Look so big, those towers and those powers and those forces of darkness and principalities, you know, in Obama's kingdom here and his henchmen here in Chicago, the mayor and all that, the godfather, they call him, and all those things, Rahm Emanuel. But when you were to fly over Chicago in an airplane, like when I leave Chicago, I'll fly back through, come out of Chicago, flying back to North Carolina. When you fly an airplane over Chicago and you look out the window, well, you'd say, wow, is that Chicago? It's pretty small. That's a little bitty old place, because your perspective is at 35, 40,000 feet, whatever it is, 35,000 feet, as opposed to on the ground, brothers and sisters. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You have to put the enemy in perspective to God, not in perspective to yourself. You know, and that's the thing that we have to do with all the situations that we face in life. You know, in the natural, like in the Philippines, where, you know, half the people don't have running water, they don't have electricity, and they live in a, you know, a shack made out of bamboo, like the pictures that I've shown, and we were able to build, so we're building a house by the grace of God with the help of a sponsor, able to build a bigger shack, kind of like in the movie The Jerk, you know, but a better house for them is, you know, it's more stable and new, made out of bamboo and some wood that's, you know, the coconut lumber, which doesn't last that long, maybe 10 years, but by the grace of God, you know, it's better than what they had. And so when we look at things, brothers and sisters, from the natural and operate in the natural and deal with these, you know, all of you guys who are all regular on YouTube, not only making videos, but you comment, and all these wacky people want to argue, and even the atheists and whack jobs with their, you know, who think that they're some kind of a spokesman for God, and in actuality they're Looney Tunes that we deal with every day on YouTube. Those few wild individuals, you know, they're operating in the flesh, brothers and sisters. They're operating down there at the level with the devil and non-believers. And what we have to do, brothers and sisters, is don't go head-to-head Marine Corps on them, but we have to come in, you know, with the Air Force. And, you know, even though I was in the Army, but, you know, obviously the Air Force is the best. The higher the altitude, you know, those fiery darts, like if they're shooting this, a lot of people that were old enough and grown back at the time of the first Gulf War, you remember they called it the AAA. They kept talking about this anti-aircraft artillery, AAA, shooting at our planes bombing. Well, you know, those AAA can only go so many thousands of feet, 3,000 or 4,000 feet, whatever it is. So with our jets and the first stealth fighters there back in the first Gulf War in Desert Storm, they would just, you know, fly above the AAA. That's all you have to do. So those fiery darts cannot hit you. You have to get up above those things, brothers and sisters, far above all powers and principalities. That's the place for us to be, brothers and sisters, to have a victory. And so if you would go read Hebrews, and he who has an ear, let him hear. If you read Hebrews chapter 3, I think it's starting in the middle of the chapter. I used to say it regularly. Now I'm trying to remember. But chapter 3 and all of chapter 4 in Hebrews, you will see that our rest is a rest of faith in the finished work of Christ. That the Lord Jesus Christ has already put the devil under his feet, and we already have the victory. It's already won. It's a matter of us having faith. Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verse 6. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. And he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So, brothers and sisters, that's the thing. To have faith in Christ, faith in God, the finished work of Christ, resting in him. So when we pray, you know, and declare victory over the enemy, we rebuke the enemy, and all of those things. Or if we come in agreement with somebody else and bind the enemy, that's, I guess I need to talk. I've done this before. But in spiritual warfare, it takes two or more to bind and loose. And one, if you're by yourself, you rebuke the enemy in Jesus' name. And the best thing to do is get another Christian who will come in agreement with you and bind the enemy. And, you know, that's, you know, if needed. But most of the time, if we rebuke, he will flee for a season. You know, we have those seasons where the enemy tries to come in like a flood. And when he does, the Lord will raise up a standard against him, the Bible says. And I'll give another reference, what I just said. When Jesus was baptized and he went into the wilderness, led into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, Jesus operated as a man, as the Son of Man. Jesus operated as a Spirit-filled Christian when he walked the earth to set an example for us, not as God. If he had come as God, of course, everyone would have had to bow to him. He came in the form of a man, the Bible says, the Son of Man, and he operated in the, not in his own power. He set that aside, came as Son of Man. He operated in the power of the Holy Spirit. So that's why when he was baptized, it said the Holy Spirit came upon him. John the Baptist testified that the Spirit remained on him. Whoever the Spirit remains on, this is the Messiah, on Jesus. And it says the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness. See, we have to be led by the Spirit. Then when he was tempted of the devil, Jesus used the armor of God and the sword of the Spirit and kept saying, it is written, it is written, it is written. And then after the devil was worn out and defeated from spiritual warfare with the Lord Jesus using the sword of the Spirit on him, then it says Satan departed from him for a season. See, so we have seasons of warfare, brothers and sisters. That's part of being a Christian. And so when you're in the battle, that's, you know, let me just say this. Spiritual warfare is God looking for an opportunity to promote you to the next level. Higher levels, bigger devils. God knows what you can handle, what you can't. He child-proofs his kingdom from people that, you know, start doing some spiritual warfare at a level that the enemy could crush them. God protects us and defends us. So brothers and sisters, those of you who are spiritual-minded and experiencing these things, you know what I'm talking about. A lot of these denominational people are tone-deaf and spirit-deaf and colorblind. And as I say, trying to explain spiritual things to a carnal-minded Christian, an old denominational mainline Christian with no spiritual experience, trying to explain spiritual stuff to them is like trying to explain colors to a blind person or music to a deaf person. You know, they can appreciate the concept, but, you know, they only go by what other people told them. And being a Christian, to all you carnal-minded, non-spiritual Christians, being a Christian, as you will say, is to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. A personal relationship. It's about our personal walk with the Lord. And we have the Word of God and the Holy Spirit and experiences we have with Christ. Being a Christian is a life, a way of life and experiences, not just looking at words. It's not only the Word, because the Bible says the Spirit gives life. You know, the Word, you know, as a matter of fact, it's talking about the law, brings death. But the Spirit gives life, brothers and sisters. So it's the quickening of the Word. Quickening of the Word is how we walk with Christ, to be led by the Spirit. So brothers and sisters, you need both to defeat the enemy. You can't wield the sword of the Spirit without being led by the Spirit. So the sword of the Spirit is the Word. See, the Spirit uses the Word as a sword. So the problem with most of your mainline denominational people, when I say mainline, I don't even mean that. I mean evangelicals, non-Pentecostal evangelicals. The mainline Protestant denominations don't even know the Word of God and don't even accept it as the Word of God. I'm talking about, let me just say it more clearly, as long as you're Baptist denominations. If you can know the Word of God, you can have a sword, but if you're not taught how to use it and led in using it in the right way, well then, it, you know, you may get lucky and you may not. That's why we need to be just like Jesus. And if Jesus was doing it, then we know we have to do it. It says he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, and he was led by the Spirit and with all the things that he did while he walked this earth as the Son of Man. Setting the example to be a Spirit-filled Christian. Okay, brothers and sisters, I got to go. Got to get on the road. It's time to, so I can get up there. I have people to meet when I get to Minneapolis, 7 o'clock tonight. So it's about 6 hours from here, so I got to get on the road. God bless you guys. I'll be loading this video tonight, so I'll already be there when you see this video. God bless you guys. May the peace of the Lord be with you. God bless.